All right, guys, so this is MBS Highway, tools and resources to position yourself as an expert. Everybody gets the emails, right? Do you know what this website is? Has everyone been on it? And
I think everybody gets it, but I don't think they know what it means. Or what,
okay.
They haven't, you know.
Does everybody know what a mortgage-backed security is? No? Okay, so the reason this is important is actually what sets interest rates for, like, basically the reason that we have the interest rates that we do is the it's based on the price that big packages of mortgages are being sold on Wall Street at any given time, and that's what influences it. So we'll go to the next slide. So before we get into the details of the website, why this stuff is important and why understanding it is important, knowledge is power. So if we understand what the market and what affects interest rates, then we can show this to borrowers and realtors, and we can explain it in detail and in a way that's clear so that they know what's going on and they don't feel tricked. It's important you can gain trust, become a resource for your referral partners, and set yourself apart from other lenders.
Well, I just want to back up a little bit, though. You said that, so you're saying that the MBS affects the pricing on the yield?
On the yield, it's the current rate that interest rates are at any given time is based on the prices that mortgage-backed securities are being bought at from investors or by investors.
Yeah, but the actual interest rate is derived from the treasury yield. So
the bond yield.
Right. So but they're purchasing them with those coupons, but they're not setting the rate. And so
it's not directly setting it. It's just what influences it.
No, that's the more macro stuff that influences. The Fed has a little bit to affects the front end of the curve. But I just want to make sure that you guys, there's a distinction there, the interest rates on the mortgages are kind of directly affected by the 10-year and the 30-year the bonds. And so they, in turn, affect, like, you know, the demand for a particular note rate. So I just want to make sure that, because we're recording this, that everyone understands the difference. So,
okay.
But yeah, you're right about what you're saying about how they're packaged, but the actual how they're derived is from those two yields.
Yeah, you can jump in because that wasn't really what I was going to explain.
Okay.
I was more just going to talk about the website.
Okay.
So if there's stuff in like that you want people to know.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can explain that. So go to the next slide. So there's key features on the website. There's information, daily updates, explaining different things. There's a learning center where you can go in and there's resources to learn all this information so you can study it, understand it. Then there's financial calculators that you can use, which I'll show you in a second. There's tools that you can use to share things with your borrowers, realtors. There's pre-made PowerPoints and slides. And actually, we'll just go ahead and go into the website. And you can see some of these tools and how you can use them. So next slide. So here's the main page. Once you go on here, I would recommend everybody going right here and taking the guided tour. They're going to explain that a lot better than I could. It's the guy who set up the site, walks you through all the resources. Some of the main important parts is you can see kind of what the market's doing. You can go to markets. There's going to be a page that explains all that. You can go to the next slide. So here's the page kind of showing where the S&P 500, Fannie Mae, showing current trends in the market. And then you go to the next slide. This is down on the same page. So this is different trends. And here's one thing that's going to be kind of really useful to us is when we're able to look at these and we can explain to borrowers why the interest rates changes. So let's say you look at this and let's say you start talking to somebody in February 16th or whatever, and the interest rate is, you know, whatever it is at that time, and it changes by the time you get to closing. And, you know, they might be kind of mad. They might say, oh, you know, we talked about a, you know, 3.75 interest rate, and now it's 4.1 or whatever it is. And they might think you're trying to trick them or you're quoting them some difference. But what you can do is you can show them there's a tool on here. You can click this right here, and you can basically draw a line and show how the interest rates have changed. And then you can export this as an image. So go to the next slide. So this is an exported image. You just hit it, export with the line you show, and you can, you know, guide them. Basically, You have an image that says, look, here's how the interest rates changed, here's where they're at. And so not only does that sort of protect you from being blamed where people think you're trying to trick them, because you can show with actual data how the interest rates are changing, but you can look at this and sort of know when the best times to lock are, because you can follow the trends and say, okay, it's rising, it's going down, and sort of figure out when the best time is to lock in. And so...
Now let's talk about this for a second. I want you guys to understand what this is showing. There's an inverse relationship to the stock market and the bond market. And so what's happening here, this is kind of what we had, a little bit of a mini crash in the beginning of the year. And so 100 is par, like we talked about, we price a loan. So look what happened to the yields. The market was tanking. The stock market was tanking. And bond prices are going up, so that pushes down the yields. So that means that the borrower is getting better premium, or you're getting better pricing, because it's at 102. Whereas here, like around Christmas time, when the S&Ps were at 2050, you're at par. And so it's very important that you understand this when you're looking at, you know, like he's talking about locking in the interest rate, pricing a loan. And so these movements in the market, like for instance, you see here, this is like right in the beginning of 2016 when the market had, you know, kind of crashed and dropped 200 points. I'm talking about the stock market. This drove interest rates down. So, but this is going up. This is the premium of the rate. So this is not the actual interest rate. So you see, this is the premium of that you're getting on that loan or that particular note rate, which is the Fannie Mae 30-year. So the premium is becoming richer because the market, it's very weak. And so remember, investors, it's a flight to quality to buy bonds, which pushes down the yields. And so, which also lowers the mortgage interest rates as well.
So is this what you were saying the other day when stocks are doing bad, these guys are jumping over and going to bonds?
Right.
And when stocks are doing good, they're staying in stocks and getting out of the bonds, and that's when it goes down, back down?
Yeah, so remember that bonds and yields have an inverse relationship. So if bonds are going up, that's a flight to quality. Investors are scared that we're going to go into a recession, right? And so that means that the yields are going down. So the rate of return that they're getting on the bond is decreasing because there's so much demand to buy the treasuries. So what this is showing, this is not the interest rates going up. This is the premium that you're getting on that rate. Okay? This is not interest rates rising. This is interest rates. When you see this, interest rates are going down. When you see this, interest rates are going up.
Right.
Okay? So don't get confused. I just want to make sure you guys understand that. When the economy is doing very good, that means interest rates are going to go up. So... and this is exactly what happened at the beginning of 2016. So the point is that for you as an originator and you're working with something that's in a volatile market, and how you can sell that to someone is that if you see something on the, a trend on the rise, you might say it's better to lock here. I see something that's going to happen. Like there's a decent probability that, we could see a pullback in the market. It might be a good time to lock rates. I think actually they sent an alert today, didn't they? To lock rates.
Yep, they did.
Yeah.
John, so
because they and this whipsaw goes back and forth, but it's just really important to make sure that you understand. You don't have to pay too much attention to this. This is just Fibonacci stuff and different retracement lines. Don't worry about all this stuff. Just look at the price action. And so is the most important thing. And then you can kind of look down here and you can see it down here too. But it's interesting, so you can put things in perspective. It helps you put some context around everything when you're talking to people about loans. And you're going to deal with some borrowers that are a little bit more intelligent and they're going to want to know about this kind of stuff. And it's good that you understand your business and this side of it and how these rates are derived. So does everyone understand the difference in the yields and the rates? No? Okay. I'll make another presentation on that. We'll go into a bigger thing on it. But just know that
the bottom line that when you're talking to people, if the market is going up, that means that interest rates are going to be going up. If the market's going down, interest rates are going down. They have a positive correlation. Okay? But bonds and the stock market have a negative correlation. And so what does that mean? Okay, tomorrow when you wake up, the S&Ps are down 50 points. What does that mean, guys?
S&P's down, that means everyone's jumping on bonds.
No, so, but what does that mean if you're selling loans? What does that mean?
I mean, it's good. That premium's going up and you want to lock.
So you get 3.5% maybe at par.
Right.
So if the S&Ps are at 2,100 tomorrow, what's going to happen?
You're going to see an increase in those rates. Or not increase in rate, but the par is going to be much lower, if not at par,
the par,
right?
The par is going to be higher.
Oh, higher, yeah. Right.
So let's say that the S&Ps go to 2,100 and 3.5 is par right now. You could see the par rate at 3.875.
Okay.
Because the market's rallying, but the stock market. So this is very good information. So whenever you're talking to people about loans and stuff, or when to lock a loan, you're quoting this guy at 3.75 and you want to float him. He wants to float. He doesn't want to lock the rate. And you're watching that. You're watching it, and you're getting closer to closing. And you know he wants 3.75, or he's going to be upset with you,
right?
Even though it's out of your control. So you have to, keep an eye on that. And if you see the market tank, might be a good time to tell Josh, hey, we got to lock this in.
Right.
Because remember, for your first 10 loans, I don't want you locking in the loans. Josh is going to lock them with you. So, but we're going to go over this. We're going to go over this a lot. So I'm not expecting you to get all this right now, but just for right now, it's just a good thing that you understand how it works a little bit. And then we're going to keep reinforcing over and over and over for you. We get it in 100%. So, all right.
Yeah, and so also with all of this, on the website, there's tools that you can use to sort of understand and go through, which I just started studying this, so I'm like, glad that you're able to explain it, because I can't, and I don't know a lot of it, but we can go to the next phase.
That's okay, you're gonna know it. So.
Yeah.
Well, on that last page, does it show the 3-month future on that, on the bottom? On the right there, which is November 16th.
Yeah, there are futures on there. There's places on the website where you can select projections.
Okay.
And then also within sort of like the resource pages, they've got basically just like people like articles saying.
Right. Okay. So,
but that's not a tell to the future.
Sure.
Yeah, it doesn't work like that. That's a completely separate market, and that has different bond securities that are in there.
Sure.
That's not a tell. The futures is a completely separate market than the cash market. So, so don't think that, that's what's going to happen in the future. Right. It doesn't work like that. That's actually all I trade is futures, pretty much. And a lot of people think that's how it is, but it's not. I wish it was like that, but it's not.
So here's another section on here. So you go to resources and financial calculator. All these different things you can select, and it'll bring you a calculator. And the cool thing about these is not just that you can do the calculations, because like we can do the calculations on a calculator, but you can export what you're doing and show it to someone else. So say you're talking to someone. I heard someone talking the other day with someone who's trying to decide whether they should, buy or rent, trying to explain why, why they would save money buying as opposed to paying rent for a long time. So you can go to the next slide.
Okay, this is great. I want you guys to send this to your clients when they back out of upping the bid on an offer. Okay, this is a phenomenal thing where you can send this to someone, and we did this several times where someone wanted to back out of the negotiation because of having to up their bid by a few thousand. And I always tell the story when I told you guys when I bought my house, I paid $200 for it, and now it's worth $280. I've only been in the house 4 years, so. You're going to forego $80,000 for $3,000.
Right.
I mean, and obviously the markets are not like that everywhere, I understand, but generally home prices do appreciate. Okay. And when you're selling people, like I've told you guys 1,000 times, 50% of the loans that come in here, you're going to have to do something to get those loans in to get them to closing. It's not going to be a layup. Not every single loan is going to be a layup. You got to tell them something. You got to do something. You've got to be able to convince them on why they have to do it. And so This is a great way to show someone with a graph and illustration on why they need to buy now. With interest rates at historic lows, especially in the Houston market, it's, you know, this is the best time to be a buyer. Yeah. So, but you have to show people that. If you just, if someone says, no, I'm not interested, then you, I mean, you're gonna go broke. You're not gonna close anything. They need everyone, you know, everyone is just like anyone else. That there has to be a reason to buy. You have to show them the reason to buy. Of course, they're going to tell you they're not interested. But you have to be able to overcome that. And that's the next part of the meeting, is overcoming objections. But anyway, yeah, please, this is good.
Yeah, so these are images right here that I exported. So if you were to be talking to a potential buyer, you type in, you know, what they're currently paying in rent, projected increases, what type of homes they're looking at. This will break it down for you and show them, and you can just send it straight in an email as an image. So it's just very, very clear. It's a very easy way to explain it, because they can just see exactly how much money that they, you know, could be potentially.
Did you work up any examples of that?
I didn't type it in. I just exported the
image. I want you to prepare a few different examples and send those out.
Okay.
Those are really good. See, look at this down here. It says the net gain or loss. See, it takes all this into account.
Hmm. Yeah, so this is the blank.
I mean, look, Sean, you're selling your house, right?
Yeah.
Look at the money you're making on that house.
Yep.
You didn't have to even work to do that.
Not a thing.
I mean, no, stop.
It's powerful,
stop,
right?
Stop and think about that for a second. You know?
It's a good tool.
I mean, you can show someone, hey, man, why are you renting? I mean, you know. I know, Flava, you want to buy a house, right? This would be perfect. You should run an exercise on this and see what it comes out of. I mean, it's, you know, it really is powerful when you send that to a borrower. Now, obviously, not everyone's going to get it, but I promise you, if we play the probabilities, you send it to 100 people, you're going to get an extra 20 loans out of it.
Yeah.
Of course, some people are going to look right over it because they do. But it's all about, again, law of large numbers. So,
yep. So we can go, you guys done looking at that? We can go to the next slide. So here's just another example of the calculator. So from the financial page, you click it, and then it's just very simple. You just type in, you know, the loan amount, number of years, annual interest rate, optional monthly principal payments, and it just calculates everything for you. So it's a pretty simple tool to use. And then this is also going to give you the results that you can export out. So basically anything that you're trying to explain to your borrowers that they, you know, they have questions about, they don't understand, this is the tools on here provide you a way to give them sort of like clear breakdown.
Okay, so looking to compare two mortgages. So you're going to get, let's say that a borrower wants to look at doing a 15-year and a 30-year. And the differences of why they would want to do that. Has anyone ever asked you guys that? Not yet. Maybe not you, but some of the other people that have been here for a while. This is a perfect thing. It will show you the net tangible benefit on why you'd want to do one over the other. What about if you have someone, like, let's say, for example, you got this big FHA loan in California or wherever, and you do fixed versus ARM, right? And the ARM is pricing 0.5% lower. And he wants to look at an ARM versus a fixed. And you can show him, hey, look, if you do an ARM, you're going to save $300 a month. And you told me you're only going to be in the house for 5 years. You can send him, you know, type this up, send it to him, boom, in a PDF over to your email. Look at this. This is how much you're going to save in 5 years, 40 grand versus if you go on a fixed. It doesn't matter to me which option you go with. I make the same. And whether it's fixed or adjustable, but this is going to lower your payment. So it's ultimately up to you. And you remember FHA does ARMs too. So, but this is like, you know, if you want to be a top producer and make the kind of money that you guys want to make, 10, 20, whatever, 30,000 a month, 50,000 a month, you've got to be doing these type of things to people. Okay? You got to be showing people this. You have to show this to everybody? No. But some borrowers, it's good to show them that. You talk about you want to deal with higher end customers. They're going to want to know about this stuff. You know? So obviously not everybody cares to look at this. I mean, you're not going to show a fixed versus an ARM to, you know, an $80,000 house farmer in Kentucky. I mean, I understand that. But I mean, he's not going to care about that. But because USDA doesn't even do adjustable rates. But
It's just that to have this knowledge to be able to pull it out when the time comes, you know, and get into the habit of, you know, I want you, if you don't mind, can you prepare a few examples of this too?
Could you put a rapid repay in there somehow with the optional additional monthly payments and stuff like that to show them on that? Or
I don't know if a rapid, no, I think the rapid repay is on the other.
Right. I just wanted to see if you maybe you could put that in there, show, you know, one versus the other. I don't think they have the right.
Well, you can take the example of that loan and then plug it into the biweekly.
Yeah.
And then you can do the other one and compare them.
Yeah. Okay.
And it doesn't have to be an adjustable versus fixed. It could be a 15-year again versus a 30. You know, and they people want to know. Actually, it's a huge amount of interest savings if you do a 15-year over a 30. Massive. The payment's a lot higher, but it's ridiculous.
Sure.
Like on a 15-year loan, most of the money goes to the principal right up front, versus, you know, a 30-year. It's, you know, so
yeah. 300 bucks.
But you can combat that by doing the
biweekly. Perfect.
Well, no, the biweekly would help.
Right.
Or adding more to the principal. But it's just it's putting, you know, you want to obviously add value, and you want to come off as an expert, as a consultant, and showing them what's the best options for them. This is a good way to educate them, because a lot of people don't know about this stuff. So, Christina, do you have a question?
I do. I have just really a point, because the home buying process can be so overwhelming for a buyer, and just everything that's involved, that after closing, this would be a good thing to revisit with them, because, again, you're building that relationship, and they can refer their friends and family to you. This is part of their closing package, and they see it, but they don't understand it. And that would be a good time to show them example based on their payments, their interest rate, making it very personal and factual, that if they just made this extra payment, how they can cut down the mortgage. They're going to love you.
Right.
They're going to want you to help their friends and family. So even after the closing, this is something good to revisit.
Yeah. And that's the whole thing, is that you have to really stop and take a moment, think about your business. And, you know, it's about getting... With every one deal that you work, there's a potential of 5 referrals from it. And if you're not tapping into that, then you're leaving, I mean, potentially over a career, millions of dollars on the table, millions. So, and you know, by adding value and putting the customer's interest first and treating them like the rock star, that's how you're going to get referrals. You know, I mean, think about it. You have 15, 20 loans working, whatever, and you get referrals off of that, man, then your pipeline's just going to grow and grow and grow. I mean, but it's never going to grow if you don't take that into account and make those changes. And the customer, yeah, I mean, if you're giving them the best service, they're going to say, hey, man, this guy's awesome. David's, you know, phenomenal. He took my call at 10 o'clock. He showed me how to save, you know, $30,000 on my mortgage. You don't think that they're going to refer you?
Right.
And some of the other things that we talked about, again, you know, when it's CTC time, you know, send them a gift to their office. Let the guy walk in front of everyone in the office and say, look, this came from David. You know, let everyone else see that. Or say, it came from David and Christina. And, you know, that's a really good thing that I've done before. It's a really good idea to always send gifts at closing, a box of chocolates or whatever. I mean, there's so many things that you can do, but... That has a lot of power into it, you know. And other people see that and they say, oh my God, where'd you get that big, huge thing of popcorn, that big tin? Well, that came from David, you know. And so that's how it starts. All these leads that I've sent you guys, a lot of them are referrals. So, anyway.
So, yeah, we're about toward the end. You can go to the next slide. So, yeah, just to recap. Just familiarize yourself with the tools and set yourself apart from competition. So kind of just exactly what we all said, or what we just said is, you know, these are tools that if we learn to use them well, then it's going to set us apart, because, you know, people are going to see that we know what we're talking about, and then they're going to trust us, and then they're going to, you know, we'll get more business. And we can also save loans from people, you know, that maybe don't understand exactly what's going on. If we can figure out ways to explain things more clearly and have tools to do that, so that they don't feel lost in the whole process.
Right.
Then we're not going to lose so many.
Right. And you know, this is the thing, guys. You really need to, all of you need to log into this and start playing around with this, so you get very comfortable with sending out these PDFs, the graphs and the amortization. You really need to get very comfortable with it. I know that you guys are comfortable right now with what you're doing, but you're never going to go from A to Z if you get outside. You have to get outside of that comfort zone. The only way life changes is when you change. That's the only way life changes. That's the only way is when you change. And you have to say, well, I'm already doing $1 million a month. Well, you can do $2 million a month. Okay. But this is a really, really, these are really good tools. And yes, I mean, you are going to close more loans, but I promise you, and you have to look at it over a horizon and not just one deal. If you do it again, if you play the probabilities, you do it over 100 loans, you're going to get an extra 20% out of it. And so, thank you, man, for, and please remember to start preparing those presentations. I want to send those out to everybody. And then there's some other stuff that I want to talk to you guys about too. So we're going to turn this off, and then can you turn on the light? And then can you print out for me the overcoming objections and the, what's this? There was another one last night.
Gotcha.
And then, Flavio, can you give me the LO hacks, please?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. This is an important thing, guys, that we really need to make sure that we're on the same page with this, because I've heard a few things around the office lately, and where we're leaving money on the table. We're letting loans go because of silly things. And I need to make sure that we're all on the same page about how we're dealing with this stuff. Is that still recording? Okay, thanks. Okay. So I've heard last few days, last week, that, you know, you're getting a line from a borrower that they got approved for more. You got them approved for 220. And the other lender got them approved for 300, so they're going with that lender. Or the other lender got them a lower interest rate, or they're going with a local lender. Here's the thing, guys, that 15% of the loans that you're going to close are going to come from overcoming objections, rebuttals. And you guys are just saying, oh, okay, well, thank you. Well, you know, call me later, or, you know, okay, sorry it didn't work out. I really want to earn your business. No, it doesn't work like that, okay? You have to respond to them and still fight for that business. 15% of loans you're going to close, you're going to face these type of objections, and you're going to have to know what to say and what to do. Okay, so it's very, very important that you respond to that, and you respond to that in a professional manner, and so that way, I mean, here, just to give an example. If a borrower tells you that they're going to go with another lender because they got a better deal, for instance, last night this happened to you, where the borrower told you that they got approved for 300 with another lender, and there's no way on earth that could be possible, because that would put them at a 60% debt ratio. So, you know, the thing is that you just don't let that go. And I'm not saying that's what you did. I'm just saying in the theory. Okay. So you're obviously going to respond to that by saying, okay, that's great. I'm glad that you're talking to somebody else, but is it really possible? Is it true? Do you have any evidence that he's gotten you pre-approved? Here's a good thing you can ask him. Ask him to show you proof from the DU approval that you've been approved for this loan. Because here's what I don't want to have happen. That you spend money on an appraisal, $500, you spend $500 on inspection, you lose your earnest money, and then you get denied for the loan, and you call me next month crying. It's happened to me 1,000 times, and I don't want that to happen to you. And it does happen all the time. A loan officer incorrectly pre-approves somebody, doesn't know what they're doing, goes off of, you know, what the person tells them over the phone, I make 50 grand a year, and the tax return shows 15,000.
right? So you have to be able to respond to that. You just can't. You're not going to make the money that you desire to make unless you fight for that. It's just not going to happen. You know, and I mean, the same thing. If you know, this is ridiculous. You have to look at where you're at in the industry. If someone tells you they're going with XYZ mortgage, say, why would you even go with the middleman? You're going to go with the middleman, they're going to charge you a higher interest rate. You can go directly with the bank here, and we're going to service your loan. If you go with them, they're going to sell the loan. You don't know who's going to get the loan. Your terms could change. You don't know what's going to happen. I'm just letting you know how it works. Mortgage companies are going to sell your loan. This bank is going to service your loan. Why would you want to do that? Put yourself in that jeopardy. Have you seen Ocwen? What they do to people's mortgages? Go look up Ocwen. Go Google Ocwen Mortgage. That's your servicer. They're one of the nation's largest servicers of mortgages for Fannie Mae. And they have massive, massive class action lawsuits against them for improperly foreclosing on people. That's where all Supreme's loans go. But you guys, you have to tell people that so they can open their eyes and they can see that. You know, Bank of England, we service our mortgages. You call me up, you know, whether it's 1 year or 5 years, it's still in the books with us. If you want to refinance, you know, we'll get you taken care of. But these are huge things to huge selling points. And you have to put that in people's mind when you talk to them. So that way they can see all of the advantages of going with you. So the other thing is that there are some things that we can do to earn somebody's business. If, for instance, that let's say that someone else is getting a better offer. I'm not going to say we're the best deal in town with interest rates, because there could be someone out there that does have a lower rate. But we can always do our best to try and beat that rate, and at least give us the opportunity to try to beat that rate or give you something else better. For instance, let's say that to get the loan in, and we're competing with somebody else, we pay for their appraisal. And what about if you offered that to the borrower? I know I've heard you recently that you lost a few loans or whatever, they're going with a local lender. Hey, look, I'll pay for your appraisal. I can, you know, we can work this out.
Buy them a refrigerator.
Or give them a refrigerator. I know that sounds funny, but no, I'm serious about it. We can pay for their appraisal. We can try to get them a lower interest rate. Do whatever it takes to get them a loan. Pay for their closing costs with a lender credit. Say, I understand that you're talking to your local lender. That's wonderful. But in the end, doesn't it matter about, okay, if I can save you, you know, $2,000 out of pocket, and I can get you a 0.25% lower rate, and you're saving $40 a month on your house payment, doesn't that make more sense? And always end it with a question. Let them arrive at it. Don't tell them what's better. Let them arrive at it. You have to ask them. It has to come out of them that they agree. If you tell them it's better, they're never going to go for it. You have to ask them, and they have to see it. Now, here's the thing that, again, don't look at this on a one-loan basis. You have to look at this as your business practice. So it's not going to happen on every single loan that you're going to get. You're going to tell someone this. But if you do it over 100 loans or 1,000 loans, you're going to get 30% of that, I promise you. And then that's exactly how it works. Let the numbers play out. If someone tells you, no, I'm still going, well, okay, that's fine. But you just keep saying it whenever that comes up, because it's going to come up. And so it's all about how you respond to it and how you deal with it. It doesn't matter what happens. The only thing that matters is how you respond to it. Remember that for the rest of your life. So, and you know, things that we can do, we can pay up to 3% for their closing costs. Well, that's a big thing Kevin's doing right now is for, you know, one thing he's offering is paying for people's appraisal to get more loans in.
Where is that coming from physically?
Huh?
Where is that appraisal money coming from?
Is it lender credit?
Lender credit?
Yeah.
So we're talking about adjusting interest rates though.
No, that's going to come out of, so that's not going to be a premium price. That's going to be with the same price. So the idea is that if we can get more loans in, then we'll you know, take it on the chin with that because of, for more deals to come
net
up.
Gain.
Yeah.
Right.
So yeah. So because we'll get more loans out of it. So it's kind of like an advertising cost in a sense. Okay. So no, the rate's not going up to pay for it. That would happen if you're going to pay for someone's closing costs.
Right.
If you're going to pay, let's say that you want to pay 2-3% for their closing costs. Let's say you can't get concessions on a deal. I mean, that happened. You know, that could happen. I can't get concessions. It's the Woodlands. It's hot. You know.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, here's 3% towards closing. Right. You can take just instead of a 3.5, I can get you at 4%, and we'll cover all the closing costs. Seller doesn't want to pay. The house doesn't have the equity to roll it in. You're gonna in hot markets. You're going to see that all day long. In Austin, you can't get that kind of concessions, 5%. No one's going to pay that.
Right.
So, so you have to think about that and use that as a tool. Because you have that now. You have that ability. So these are really big things. And most of the time, from what I saw, like when that guy came in here yesterday, we were 0.5% lower than Bank of America. You know? So most of the time, I think that we beat out a lot of the market. But there are some that are very, very competitive, and we'll do our best to try to compete. But the point is that the whole reason behind all this is to increase your conversion. That's the whole point behind all of this. If someone tells you, you have to be able to respond to these things and deal with it so you can, you know, obviously increase your pipeline. If you don't, you're only going to close a few loans a month. You have to be properly trained on this and then repetition and speaking and talking about this to people. Because it's going to come up, I promise you. And if you just get steamrolled over and say, okay, say thank you, then, I mean, that's how you live your life too. And you can't be like that. I mean, you have to be able to overcome that. If someone, as soon as they call you or you call the lead and they say, I'm already going with someone else, they say, that's great. Well, here's what I can do for you. Take a look at this. You're going to go buy a house, the biggest purchase of your life, and just get one opinion. Who does that? I mean, when you go to the doctor, you just go see one doctor. If you have a problem, aren't you going to get a second opinion? See, you change it on them, and then you ask a question like, because it's true. No one's going to have a serious disease and just go talk to one doctor. You're going to borrow $200,000 and just take one person's advice. Now, obviously, again, it's not going to work every time, but if you use that over and over and over again, it will work, and you'll make a hell of a lot more money. I promise you that. At the end of the day, that's what it's about, is you making money and helping people become homeowners and giving them the best deal that you can. So, but it's just the way that business works, and you have to know how to talk to people. And you're never being rude to anybody, but you're just getting them to think, and so that way they can see, again, just like with the property appreciation, that's a lot of people they get stuck in the moment, and they get emotional, they don't want to up the bid or whatever, and they're not seeing the big picture here. Hey man, when I sell this house in 5 years, this thing's gonna be worth a lot more. You know, I mean, if you look at, you know, historically, real estate generally appreciates 2-3%, you know, and so now I know that's not everywhere, but there are some places it's like, if some places higher, some places where Mark's at, it's like 7% in Frisco, and some places it's lower. Where was it? What was it in Miami?
About 8%.
Was it?
Yep.
That's insane.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, you really... Basically, what you're saying is that if I up my bid by 5,000, I can effectively make 7.5% this year. You have to have them look at it like that. I should just show that. You know what I mean? So, like, if you have some deals that you're working in San Francisco or whatever, very expensive market. Or I don't know, aren't you working something over there?
More expensive than New York now.
Yeah, it's real expensive. So. Those are things that you can show people, and you know. So by employing all of this, it's going to help you to, how I quantified it over my career is that, I made an extra $5,000 a month by doing these things. You know,
just by doing these few things. I said for you guys, you'd make an extra $2,000 a month. So, which I firmly believe. Now, do I have any broken out detailed statistics on it? No, just my experience. And all I can give you is what I know. And so, and by doing all these things, it's made all the difference in the amount of income I have that I made. And I just know that if you guys do it, you're going to be very successful with it. So, and now you don't have to use everything I say verbatim. But you can morph it into something that. But you have to fight for some. Not every loan is going to be a layup. It's just not. It just doesn't work like that. So you're going to have to get very comfortable. Huh?
He said fucking rate.
Well, you're still in training, so.
They're all.
Actually, hey man, that deal in West Virginia had today was good. That's a good loan, man. I'll take that all day long. So, what else? You guys start to really think about these things and put them into practice. The other thing that I want to go over with you guys real quick is this. I'm not going to go through all the LO hacks, but we're going to start going through this to get through it to make sure you guys understand. Because I put this big encyclopedia here, and I know a lot of people don't know what it is yet or why would you put all these things here. And so this is a quick reference to go to when you're working and a situation comes up. You say, oh, man, what do I do here? You know, it's a great go-to. So we're just gonna break this down slowly. We're not going to go through all of them tonight. But, okay, somebody asked me the other day for USDA business losses. Does anyone know, like, if someone has a business and they're reporting income or losses, how that affects the USDA loan?
Previous year's loss, you would have to factor it into the current year's income and just deduct it from the gross monthly for the previous year's loss.
Okay, now that you're talking about for qualifying for debt ratio?
Right.
Okay, now what about for cap eligibility?
I don't think a loss would deduct from their effective income, would it?
No, it doesn't.
Yeah.
It doesn't.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
I want to make sure you guys, this is very important that you get this right here. Okay. So if someone has a business loss, that gets deducted out of their gross income for debt ratio qualification. Okay. But if they have a business loss, it does not deduct for the USDA income cap. So if the income cap for Harris County is 80K, the guy has 70 or 80K at his base job, right? And then he has a $10,000 loss from a business that he owns. You can't use that to have him qualify for the income cap.
Same with unreimbursed, right?
No, unreimbursed you can.
You can deduct unreimbursed for income cap.
Absolutely.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely, yeah.
I thought.
Yeah, done it a million times.
Okay.
Unreimbursed.
Yeah.
And child care.
Unreimbursed and child care.
But the child care has to be on the tax returns, right?
No, not necessarily.
Really?
What did Josh publish? Josh published something the other night on that. I didn't say it.
It's just 480 credit for everybody 18 or under. That's automatic. But any additional child care, because I have one like that right now, and they claim it on their tax returns, but I think he's saying a letter from the child care provider.
Right. I've never seen it to where they require tax returns for that.
Okay.
All right. So I want to go back over that again to make sure that we understand it. So if somebody has a business that they own, right, whether they're self-employed completely or they're a W-2 wage earner and they own a business too, if they have business losses, those are deducted out of the gross earnings, and they have an effect on the debt-to-income ratio, okay? But that business loss does not have anything to do with the USDA income cap. Now, conversely, income profit from a business does. See, so it works against them if they're making money. So if the person has profit from the business, then that gets added to the income, obviously, for debt ratio qualification, and it gets added for the USDA income cap.
Yeah.
You see, so that's something to keep in mind. Now, unreimbursed,
can work for you or work against you with USDA. I had this happen many times where I had a guy in Midland, you know, Odessa, making 150 grand a year on a W-2, and you get his tax returns for 70 grand because he had $80,000 in unreimbursed expenses.
You're good.
So now he can qualify for USDA because he has all these unreimbursed expenses, right? Or I had a welder one time was making 250 grand a year, and he sent me his tax return show 90 grand. After the now the unreimbursed is hiding, doesn't show it on the AGI, the adjusted gross. It hides on line 2106. So on the AGI it shows 250, and you go, oh yeah, he's making 250. No, he's not making 250. He didn't say all the pages of the tax return. And so it's way like in page 7, line 2106, and it shows all the expenses the guy had. And right now, most people have gotten savvy. They're using that. 70% of the people I've seen recently are using unreimbursed expenses in some way. She's traveling over here. Hey, I'm going to write that off. I spent $200 in gas. So I bought this $2,000 suit. I'm writing it all off. Okay. Well, yeah, you can do that, but it's going to affect your purchasing power too. So, you know, it's just something to think about. So for USDA, if the person has the unreimbursed expenses, it will lower their qualified income for debt ratio and income cap. So just keep that in mind. These are really important things. And I know that there's a few nuances there. It seems a little confusing. If you guys have any questions about it, just come get me or Josh about it. It will help you to make sure, because you don't. This is the thing that these little differences will determine if you close, you know, 4 loans or 8 loans in a month. See, the loans are there. The loans are everywhere. The phone's ringing all day. The customers are coming all over. But if you can't identify what a deal is, then it's going to walk right past you. Right? I'm just, you know. The business is there, but if you can't see it, then it's not there. I mean, it's, you have to be able to, you know, be sharp and pick that up. One other thing here, before anybody ever goes under contract, you have to communicate with the realtor to make sure that the dates for closing, concessions, and everything's in line. You got a contract come in today, and it's, you know, it's not a big deal. You have to go back and get some stuff fixed on it, you know, because the, you know, potentially, well, we don't know about the closing date yet, but you should never get an executed contract and be surprised. Oh, why do you put 30 days for closing for USDA? I don't know. Was I supposed to do something about that? Yeah, you are supposed to do something. You're supposed to talk to the realtor and tell them this is what you need for closing. It's in the approval letter. And by now, you guys should have had 30 conversations over the last month. And, you know, this is the stuff that, or it might make a seller pissed off. Now you have to go back and get an amendment or redo the whole thing for 45 or 60 days. You need to get that stuff right up front. The same thing with concessions. You know, if you know that deal needs 5% concessions and that's what it needs, then that's what we need. And if the seller says no, then the buyer's got to come from somewhere, or we're doing a lender credit or something. But it just can't be, she gave me the contract, here it is, I don't know what to do. You know, because you can't close loans like that. So does everyone understand that? You have to be in accord and communicating with your realtor, so that way they know, so that way we're all on the same page. And the other thing is that if you do it that way, everyone's going to perceive you as an expert. You know what you're doing, and they're going to have a good experience. Versus if you're coming back and having to change a contract 3 times, you're like, man, this guy doesn't know what he's doing. I mean, doesn't, you know? It's like a surgeon. If you have to go back to him after he does surgery on you 2 or 3 times, man, this guy doesn't know what he's doing. You know, so it doesn't look good. Okay, now this on a loan with in a community property state, this is a big thing that I want to make sure that everyone understands, that if you're doing a government loan in a community property state, okay, and that person's married, you have to pull the credit on that non-purchasing spouse, even if they're not going on a loan, you have to pull their credit. There's no objection to that. There's no way around it. So if let me say that again. In a community property state like Texas, if they're doing an FHA, USDA, VA loan, and they're married, and the guy tells you, no, I don't want to put her on the loan, she's got bad credit, there's no way around that. You have to pull the spouse's credit. Now, her debts, her credit score is irrelevant. We don't care about the credit score. What we want to know about is her debt. And that debt is going to get added into the liabilities for qualification.
So when we do that, we're not putting it under the co-borrower. We're just running her credit.
You can put her as a co-borrower and then take it off later.
Okay.
But you need those debts in there.
Right. Okay.
And if she's got collections, they get added to the debt ratio. Gotcha. Okay. Now, the only way that you can go around this is go conventional. If you go conventional, it doesn't matter. You don't need to pull their credit. They still have to go to closing. If he tells you, I don't want her on the title, she still has to sign spousal documents. And so she's still going to have to either send a mobile notary or she has to go. Sometimes you get stuff like that where it's a divorce or something where, they don't want one of them on the title. They can basically go there and sign the documents, and then they can do a quick claim deed and get the deed out of her name. I mean, there's things you can do on that. But if that happens, just get me. We'll get the real estate attorney to help out with that. Don't start telling the person what to do, and you don't want to get into that type of mess. So there's things that can be done. But the point is that just know that. And the way you explain that to someone, look, this is not me. This is a HUD requirement. A lot of people, they get mad at you and think that you want to know what the wife's credit is or the husband's credit. It's not that. It's a government requirement for these type of loans. And it's only, I think there's only what, how many community, 9 community property states?
7.
There's 7?
Yeah.
Okay. Right. There's a list right there.
9.
Okay, there's 9. Okay. Okay, this is an important thing I want to make sure you guys understand on child support income. On child support income with USDA, so they're going to require, it has to be legitimate child support from a divorce decree, and it has to be court ordered through an attorney general, and there has to be a 12-month payment history, and it has to be verified.
So if they're paying like with cash in the account?
Unless there's a ledger from the attorney general that shows the proof of the payments. Or they can get 12 months bank statements from the ex. So this is, let's say this, right? They've been divorced for 3 years. On the divorce decree, it shows that the wife gets $500 a month of child support, and then the underwriter says, well, show me the money. Well, maybe he's not paying it. What if he's not paying it? So you see, with USDA, they're going to go a step further, and they want a 12-month history, either through canceled checks, 12 months bank statements. So you can't use that. What I'm getting at here, guys, you can't use that for qualification unless they can prove it. You see? So with FHA, it's different, though. With FHA, you don't need proof. So if someone says, yeah, I'm getting child support, I've been divorced for, a year, and he's paying me $1,000 a month, and is on the divorce decree, then you can go with that.
Oh, you don't need it for FHA?
No.
Oh, sweet. So if they have a court order, they weren't married, but they had a court order, no, paid it in cash, so there's no trail, she says, for whatever it is.
It's a court order, so they're not divorced? They're legally separated with the court? Yeah, you can use it. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Because it has to be a legal signed by a judge, the court order.
Okay, and then that's how much? It's 25%, right? You can grow
FHA. Yeah. 15 for FHA.
25 for FHA.
What about SSI? 15.
15 FHA, 25 USDA.
Okay. So So 15% for fixed income, FHA, 25% for USDA. Okay, let me see here. This happened the other day. This is a good one. You guys are going to see this. Let's say that somebody wants to has anyone ever seen this before, where someone wants to go and buy a house and they have a mortgage on their credit and they say, oh, that was from a divorce. I don't have that property anymore.
Mm-hmm. I did.
So that happens a lot. So so with USDA, if somebody is divorced and they still have a mortgage report on their credit, what do you think they're going to want?
They're going to want proof of payment from ex-wife.
Right. And is the ex-wife going to want to provide that?
He doesn't want to talk to his ex-wife.
Sometimes they do something. I guess it depends what you can give them or bribe them. I don't know. But no, they want 12 months of proof of payment.
Right.
Okay, so do not, the whole point behind this, do not pre-qualify someone for USDA. So, oh, that's okay, no problem. It's in a divorce. I can just omit that and close my eyes to it. No, you cannot. You have to have 12 months of canceled checks or proof of payment that the ex is actually making the mortgage payment in order to omit it. Now, with FHA, guess what? Don't need it. Just need a divorce degree.
So, if it's not a divorce decree?
Then you can't omit it. How would you be able to omit it if it's not a divorce decree?
I don't know.
No, you have to have a divorce decree.
So, in the divorce decree would say she's going to live at the house.
Well, that's her. It's the debt is her responsibility.
Oh, that's what
we're
saying.
Okay. And then she's going to be
so the divorce decree affects outside. It doesn't affect the credit. Like, the decree isn't going to go into the actual note and take a person off the mortgage.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
Yeah. No, it's just basically, you know, it's transferring. And the person still also has the mortgage in their name, and they may even have the title in their name.
Yeah.
But they have this legally binding, you know, agreement signed by a judge saying that that debt now belongs to that person.
I got you.
So now if they miss the payment, it's still going to affect the other person's credit, though.
Yeah.
You know? So that's why USDA wants the 12 months to cancel checks. FHA is more liberal. That's why Josh is real big about, hey, man, if you're running these issues, just go FHA. Because a lot of times you're not going to be able to get all this stuff. You know, so I know that a lot of stuff is probably like, you know, but we're going to go over this a lot. So it's just, you know, so don't worry. It's just all about repetition and getting used to it. But I wanted to do this. We're going to start doing this in many segments. This is just one series. We're going to do many more of them. There's a lot of stuff here. But it's just to get it going. See here. Okay. On the, you guys know on the collections, does anyone know what the guidelines are for non-medical collections for FHA and USDA?
2,000 or less, you don't count it. Or under 2,000, you have to count it. Over 2,000 is 5%.
Right. So
as a monthly liability.
Right.
Okay.
So but let's think about that for a second, though. So what, let's say someone has $5,000 in collections, right, and they're non-medical. What can that person do?
Pay it down to 10 or less payments?
Under 2,000.
Okay. Yep.
Right? What about it? Because if you use the 5% multiplier on 5,000, how much is that monthly?
On 2,000?
No, 5,000. How much is that monthly into their debt ratio?
250 bucks.
Right. Well, what about what if that kills the deal?
That's a car note. Easy, yeah. Man.
So what can you do then? What do you think you can do?
Get it down below.
Okay. What if you get it below 2,000? What happens?
Then it doesn't count for anything.
Okay. What if they didn't? What if they say I don't got $3,000?
Credit repair specialist.
What would you do with a credit repair specialist?
Maybe you can get it removed.
Okay, so file this, you get it removed.
Right, which is better than actually paying it. Yeah. If it's removed, it does look better.
So you can gamble and throw the dice and spend $500 on credit repair.
Well, that's what you got to tell them.
No, I know. I want to know. The thing is, you guys have to have this in your mind when you're talking to people instead of just saying, I don't know what to do.
No, I had that exact same thing.
You're going to have it all the time. Yeah. But this is your money. Every deal is worth $2,000 to you guys, man. So you got $1,500, $2,000. Everything is. You have hundreds of thousands of dollars passed by. If you can't go and grab it because you don't know what to do, then you have to really understand that. So if you don't believe that, then it's never going to come to fruition. Like I told you the other day, you had five loans, and you do. Next month you're going to get three more loans. You're going to get better and better and better and better. So the other thing that you can do is you can enter into a repayment plan. And a lot of these collections are 4 or 5 years old. After 4 years, a collection agency can no longer come after someone and sue them for the debt. So normally they'll settle for 10 cents, 20 cents on the dollar, and you can make a payment plan for $20 a month. Now, they have to be in that payment plan for 3 months in order to use it. So let's say that, Sean, you get a deal where the person can't pay down the collection under 2,000, and they're serious about getting the loan, they can wait till August or July. Then they enter into the payment plan, you put that into your drip campaign, and you're pre-approved, and you follow up with them, and it's a July deal. You're going to be here in July, right?
Yeah.
Okay, then you need a loan in July.
Yep. Yeah.
So, it's just going to add to your pipeline. So, that you have to look at it like that. You say, no, I can't help you, and it doesn't work, or then you're going to miss out on that opportunity. And so the whole point for me is my goal here is to transfer everything I know about this business into your mind so you can seize the opportunity to take it. And so, because I told you, this is a phenomenal business. I made millions and millions of dollars in this business, and you guys can too, but you have to be able to see it. And it's little tiny things making these distinctions, and whether you see a loan or not. You guys hear, how many times do you hear where someone says that, I just got denied, and you look at it and say, man, this is a no-brainer. I heard David selling that to someone the other day. They get, who was that you're talking to? A Bank of America or Wells Fargo denied them? Oh, you know. Yeah, it happens all the time. And so, because people don't know what to do. Most people don't know. Some of them do. They're earning a lot of money if they do. Whoever's a master, then that is making a lot of money. I can just tell you that.
Well, I got one the other day. She said she talked to the guy, and they didn't qualify her, and then the guy never called her back. And then she called me, and she's like, yeah, I'm thinking I don't qualify because he never called me back. And she was super easy. Like, yeah. She had 650.
I know. It's unbelievable.
Like, easy.
You know. Well, that's what, you get people like that, right? Brian Neal. Look, he's at home watching Family Guy right now. So, no, I like him. We're friends. We're good. So, I know you guys have gone through. Is there anything that's pressing that came to you that you want to talk about? Anything that came up that? Okay. If you see, has anyone seen on a tax return business loss that was for mileage? Has anyone gone through a tax return and see where there's been a deduction for mileage?
Yeah.
Okay. Fernando, how much can you add back in for mileage? And what is that, by the way? What is mileage? What does it mean?
It's just a business expense for travel. I think you do like 10 or 15 cents, is it, per dollar?
22 cents?
22 cents.
22 cents?
Yeah.
But they need you can't just do it automatically if it's on tax return. You need something extra, right?
Well, now, what if somebody has business mileage deduction and they have depreciation? Then
depreciation,
what?
I think you can, for sure. Mileage.
Appreciation, you have that.
No, but I mean, if it's for the same vehicle.
No, like you can't double whammy it, I don't think.
Okay. Well, no, people try to do that.
Yeah, Sean tried to give somebody a food stamp the other day, and what? He tried to gross it up.
There's a Snap card. She said she got $300 on a Snap card. I said, I want the Snap card. I'll gross it up.
He tried to give him food stamps, and then he tried to gross it up.
So is that like SSI? I don't know.
No, can't do that.
I know.
I know, okay, SSI. I want to make sure that you see. Okay, this is going to happen all the time. I just got denied from my bank that said I don't qualify. You look at the tax return, it shows they drove 80,000 miles last year, right? So 80,000 times 22 is 16,500. You can add that back into the income. See, boom. Yeah. Now, let's say that they have in there 30,000 in depreciation on that vehicle, and they have the deduction for the mileage. You can't add back both. You can only do one. Normally, the depreciation is actually going to equal or be very close to the mileage deduction. What do you think about?
No matter what, you just can't. Why can you not add both of them?
They don't allow it. It's just kind of like a double dipping, and they just don't allow. Underwriter.
So you just,
most
is
of the time,
that when you file taxes also.
Yeah. No, this is on the tax return. Now, here's the thing, though. If somebody's a W-2 employee, like a wage earner, we cannot accept depreciation from them. This is only for people that own a business or they're self-employed or they're a wage earner and they own a business. So let's say that you work here, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you have a restaurant that you own, or you have a restaurant that you own too. And so you can claim the loss on the restaurant side. Let's say you have a trucking company and you drive freight and you have a loss for all the mileage. Well, you can do that. Because you also work here too, but you also have that business, and that's claimed under your LLC or whatever you have. So, but you as a person, you driving here from work every day, you can't claim the depreciation. You can legally claim it, but not for the purpose of qualifying for a loan and adding that back.
Okay.
So, I mean, legally you can claim the depreciation, but for purposes of the loan, the underwriter is not going to accept it unless you it's through a business. And so that's just a very important thing to understand, because if there are a lot of people, and there's nothing wrong with that, but a lot of people will do that. They'll I mean, you're driving from here from, you know, and you want to use that depreciation to qualify, you just can't use it to add back in. In other words, if the person has, you know, their debt ratio is too high and you see depreciation right there and you want to add it back to the loan to lower the debt ratio, you can't do that if they're a wage earner. So Mark, what's the process if someone has is active duty military? Can they get a VA loan?
Can they get a VA loan?
Yeah, sure. What's the process?
You get a statement of service from command, and then
You don't get a DD-214?
No, they're still
DD-214. You're still DD-214.
So you get a statement of service, which got that one right here. Anyway, upload that to the VA portal, and then you get your certificate of eligibility. It'll tell you how much you know they qualify for. In the case of my guy right now, he had qualified the max 417.
Okay. Now, what about if I had a VA foreclosure
6 years ago, then what?
VH foreclosure is fine 6 years ago.
Okay, but is that going to affect my entitlement?
Possibly.
Now what can happen?
You could potentially lost the entitlement for the amount that you proposed on.
Or the deficiency.
Yeah, right.
Okay. Yeah, because the lender would have sold the property.
Right. Yeah. For the deficiency. Right.
Yeah. Right. So then I could potentially still get another VA loan, but there might be some conditions with that.
Right.
Which could be could affect the influence of loan amount.
Well, absolutely could affect loan amount if you bought for 200 or foreclosed on and you had a deficiency of 100 and now you're at what, 317?
Yeah.
Lost 100,000.
Okay.
In your eligibility.
Okay. Now let me ask this. Let's say that I live in California and I have a home that I own and I have a VA loan on it and I get transferred to Houston. Can I get another VA loan?
We're 100% eligible. You can have multiple VA loans, but the total amount can't be over 417.
Okay, now so how does it tell me, I mean, so how would I go about finding out what I qualify for that?
On your COE, it'll let you know what your eligibility is. And if you're 100% eligible, you can go up to the HUD conforming loan limit 417. So you can get multiple homes as long as the total loan amounts don't exceed 417.
Okay, so it'll show on my COE what I'm entitled to.
Uh-huh.
Well, you regain your eligibility if this guy was to sell his house, mm-hmm. and essentially pay the bank back what he owed.
Right. Right.
Through the sale of the home.
Right.
He could regain his eligibility all the way back.
Right.
And then he could continue that for the rest of his life.
Yeah. 417. Okay. Yeah. Now what happened? Let me ask you this. Let's say that I'm 100% disabled vet. Okay, what benefits do I have if I want to go buy a house?
You don't have to pay the upfront mortgage. It's one thing I know.
We have the upfront and the property tax.
Okay, now I don't have to pay the property taxes. Why not?
You're 100% disabled.
Okay, can David pre-approve someone and waiving the property taxes?
No, that's after they close. So it's a calculator for.
Better calculate it. Okay.
Unless what?
Letter.
A letter from the borrower?
A letter. A letter from the president.
Hello.
Wave by that.
Wave that?
Huh?
I mean, you can get that?
Well, I'm asking you. I mean, I
don't know. I thought you could.
David, you're the guy in this example. What would you do?
I would deny it right there.
I
don't know. I mean, there's a person right now that I'm working with that's telling me the exact same thing. I'm trying to qualify him. And I'm saying, hey, we don't have enough income. Is there any other income? And you keep telling me, well, we don't have to pay these property taxes because my partner is disabled and the home is like a historic site.
Wow. His partner?
Yeah, another income. Man, okay.
Now, with VA loan, who can the co-borrower only be?
Well, this isn't VA. This
spouse. Yeah. I mean, they can still get it, but it's like 12.5% or something like that now. What is it?
Huh?
They can still get the loan, but it's like 12.5% now.
Okay. Hold on. So I want to make sure that we don't lose sight here. So if a veteran is 100% disabled, okay, it's true that they can have the property taxes omitted, but generally that's after closing. They have to go and get that taken care of, and they can remove that from their escrow.
Okay.
Now, there are some counties that I've seen, I've seen this in San Antonio, it's a huge veteran city, and Bexar County will, actually they've done it for me, or for the borrower, and provided a letter stating that the borrower didn't have to pay the property taxes. And so we closed like a $300,000 deal in San Antonio, and the guy was only making like $3,000 a month, $3,500 a month on fixed income, and the taxes were like $600 a month. So we were able to waive that because of the letter. So you can't always rule it out, but most of the time you're right, they won't. So
is that with any loan programs? So if I was to get a letter for
no, this is well
for USDA.
This is for VA.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't think USDA will do that. You can definitely check into it. Now, you guys know you can also, you know, you guys can, if you have a question about something, you can email the USDA directly. State office for Texas, Florida, whatever, and ask them a question. You don't have to just, you know, ask me. You can be filtered through me, and I can show you how to do it. It needs to be done a certain way. But let's say this property, I don't know about this house. This house looks really weird, and you might want to send it to me. Can we do this? Or, you know, most of the time, I'll be able to tell you that, and you don't need to waste the resources for that. But you can actually contact them, too. So if you have questions.
Say the example earlier where he goes from, say, the basin, Camp Pendleton in San Diego, and it goes to Fort Bragg here in Houston. Once he moves, he keeps both houses and they equal 100,000, 100,000. Is he able to rent that other house out in San Diego and make an income on that?
Okay, this is the next question I'll talk about. Okay. Rental properties. So let's say, okay, in this example, if someone owns a house, right, like he had said, in San Diego, and they're going to move to Houston, and they have a VA mortgage in San Diego, then they want to get another VA loan here in Houston or Fort Bragg. And let's say that you need that rental income or you need more income to qualify. He can't qualify with two mortgages. So if he leases out the property, can you omit the debt, Fernando?
You have to have a 12-month rental history in the lease agreement, but yeah, you can omit it.
The only way you can do is with 12 months?
Yeah. 12-month rental history and the lease agreement, but expected to continue. Oh, it has to be on tax returns. Yeah, the rental income
is. Is there any other? Is there any other option?
What program is it?
VA.
To omit the payment, any other option? No.
How much of the payment can you omit?
75.
I think whatever the 75%. Yeah, the
75% rate.
Yeah, the rental rate. I think you can go full 100% if they have the. No, wait. I don't know. I don't know about VA, yeah, but I think USDA FHA is 75%.
Yeah, 75 on them. I don't know about VA.
Okay. No, it's a trick question. So, couple things here. There is another option. So it wouldn't be fair to somebody that they'd have to qualify with two mortgages if every program required a 12-month rental history. Because there's several instances where you move and you need to buy another house, right? Let's say that you moved up here and you want to buy another house. So you wouldn't be able to because you own another home?
Right.
No, that's not logical. So there's another way, and you could do it immediately without 12 months of cancel checks. But you have to have 25% equity in the property to do it. So let's say that Sean moves to Houston. He wants to buy the house that you're renting. I'm going to buy it right now. Okay. Well, huh? Yeah. He's going to say that you want to lease out the house in Miami right now.
Right. But I have to have LTV 75%.
You have to have 25% equity.
Oh, equity. Okay.
So with the 25% equity, that's all you need?
Well, and then you need to lease out the house too.
Right.
What if it's already leased out?
That's fine.
And 25% equity.
You're good.
25% equity.
Well, then you need to lease it out.
Half
yeah, because that's, and then that's the other thing is that it's, you're not omitting the payment to the mortgage. You're giving them 75% credit
of the
rent.
Right.
So whatever the rent is, you can only give them 75% credit of that.
Is that because of different things that could happen to the house that you're the owner liable for?
No, it has to do with the rental role in the area for building properties. There could be a fluctuation. And so so let's look at this for example. Let's say that they're receiving $1,000 a month in rent, okay? But the mortgage is $1,500. So how much can you give him credit for?
$750.
Okay, so he's upside down then, right? $750. So you have to put that into his debt ratio. Now, normally that doesn't happen where they're upside down by that much. Normally it's marginal.
Right.
Because most people aren't going to rent out their
house. For under.
Yeah. Sometimes they do. I've seen it.
Right.
It depends on the market.
Bad market.
On the timing. So, but this is important stuff because see, here's the thing. All these little nuances are going to determine, again, whether you're making $20,000 a month or $5,000 a month.
Believe me.
Which loans was that for?
Once for all loans.
For all of them, 25%.
Yeah, conventional FHA, USDA. So now with USDA, you're going to need 2 years of rental, I think.
You still need 25% equity if they've been leasing it, or they've been leasing it out for the 12 months.
No,
okay.
No. You don't need the 25% equity. But you know, it's just important that you know you guys you know really take note of this. I don't expect you to get this in one night tonight. That's not reasonable. But really spend the time invest in your future and your career. Because I mean, if you stop and think about it, I'm just going to ask you this. I mean, now that you have you're armed with this knowledge. I mean, Mark, honestly, since you've been here, how much money do you think that you left on the table, if you had to quantify it? Just off the top of your head.
Think about it, man.
Well, no, but it's not to make you feel bad, but it's to open to see, so that way you can see, you know, it's again, just to show you that, you know, knowledge is very powerful, and you can monetize off it if you know something. And so,
I mean, just from the stuff I know of, at least $5,000.
Okay.
And that's just what I know of.
Okay. I would think since you've been here, you've probably about 30 to 40,000 since you start talking to customers. And so, but the thing is, again, we all have. I've lost millions of dollars because of stuff I screwed up on. Probably $20 million because I didn't know what I was doing. But that's the cost of education, and you have to learn it. You know, how else are you gonna get? But I told you the first loan that I closed, I had to pay $1,200 to close it because I screwed up on it. Does that mean you quit and get out of the business? No, there's just a deal, and there's another deal. There'd be more deals. It's your learning. You have to learn, and you have to get better. And so, that's what it's about. And so, it's just to make you aware, because, you know, you have to be able to identify what your mistakes are to get better. You see, self-examination is what it's all about. You have to be able to examine yourself daily. To get better, and that those tiny bits of progress is what's going to take you from here to here. But if you don't examine yourself, how can you get better? You know, you have to know why is it you do what you do. Why? And when you understand that, then you have a limited power, and you can change it. So, it's very very important. It's very powerful. So. There's a lot of really good stuff in here. Has anyone gotten inquired with you guys about refinancing cash outs?
I got one.
Are you
right
guys
now.
Delirious about that or trying to figure it out or?
I'm going through one right now. It's actually a refi, like 203K. It's going to be one that I'm going to take step by step, probably with Josh, to go through. But everything's looking good on it. It's just the 203K is one of those.
It's a refinance?
Refi, okay. Yeah. They own the house.
Okay. The cash out is actually not considered a 203K. So a cash out is where the person's taking equity, cash out of their property to refinance. And so let's say that somebody has a house that's worth $100,000 and you want to refinance to pull out cash. Well, you can't. Your house is like a piggy bank. It's an asset, and you can pull money from it. And so, Texas is the only state that's prohibited with FHA to do a cash-out refinance and VA. So you cannot do a cash-out refinance in Texas with VA or FHA. Okay, but conventional, obviously, you can. And you can go to 80% of the appraisal. Okay, so if a house is worth $100,000 and they owe $50,000, how much cash can they take out, David?
If they owe $50,000?
Yeah, the house is worth $100,000.
Which program?
Texas A6 conventional.
They only do 80%. So they can cash out
$40,000? 30 minus closing
costs. Yeah, $30,000.
$30,000, okay.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Good try.
Not
producing.
No, man.
don't quote anybody that.
But what's the closing cost? It's 80% of equity. Is it?
The closing cost?
Or what they can take out is?
80% of the appraisal, LTV.
Oh, okay. Does it matter what percentage of equity they take? Can they take everything out if they want?
Well, that's what that is. So if the house is worth 100, the Texas law says that you can only go to 80% of what the house is worth, which is $80,000. So they have to keep in 20,000 or 20% equity into the property. So the maximum loan is 80. See, they owe 50. So 80 minus 50 is
30.
So that's how much they can net less they're closing.
Okay.
You see, you can't go to the full amount of 100. Now, let's say you're in Louisiana, and the guy says, I want to do a refinance cash out. Well, now you can go do FHA. In FHA, you can go to 85%. Or if it's VA, you can go to 90%.
So it's 80 on what?
On conventional. So here's a really good thing that how I started the business just doing refinances. That's all I did. I never did purchase, never did anything else, just refinance. The best loan is a refinance cash out. You know what I used to do? We'd pay off their mortgage, we'd pay off their car, pay off all their credit cards, and we'd show them a spreadsheet. Okay, their current mortgage is 800, the car is 600, the credit cards are 700. Sir, you're paying $2,100 a month and you make 3,000. How are you doing that? He doesn't even know how he's doing. He's robbing Peter to pay Paul. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to get rid of all this. And now you're going to have one new payment for $650 a month. So I'm going to save you how much? $1,450 a month. That's how you show it to him. Now you see over here, you're paying $2,100. Now I can get you to pay off everything. Now you just pay $650. You can use the savings, the $1,450, and reapply that to the mortgage and have the house paid off in 5 years. You can be completely debt-free in 5 years if you want to do it this way. By taking that extra $1,450 and applying it to the payment every month, you'll be completely debt-free and have everything paid off in 5 years. Because that extra $1,450 goes straight to principal. Or you can use it for your retirement. You can fund your retirement account. There's endless possibilities what you could do. But he doesn't see that. He's drowning in his mind. He thinks he's drowning. And so refinances are, I mean, you're going to get these calls, and if you don't know what to tell these people, then they're going to go somewhere else. Or, you know. So
what makes that refi do that is because you're getting them a better rate?
No, because you're spread over 30 years.
Okay.
So right, you're paying off. So he's got 23,000 in credit cards. He's got he's got a car note, it's 5 year AM, he's paying 600, and then he's got a mortgage right now that he's paying off. It's because the monthly payments are so high.
Okay.
And so what happens is by paying it all off and consolidating and now having just one low payment over 30 years, you've basically cut his debt by, you know, 67%.
I got you. So you're not even worried about the monthlies on those other ones because it's going to work out.
All that other stuff needs to pay off.
Right, because it's going to work out to 30 years, really.
Right.
It doesn't matter if it's a car loan for whatever. It's just because it's going into that 30-year block. Gotcha.
Right. So, but the thing is, it'll free up cash flow for him.
Gotcha.
And the bottom line is that you put your client, your customer, in a better financial situation.
Right. Definitely.
You know? So, I mean, the thing is that, you know, you're going to get these calls. You're going to have to know how to help them and show them the way. And so, so that's a very effective
yeah.
tool. So, but I encourage you guys to definitely to be all over that. So any questions on any of this stuff? Is anything?
No, it's now we can take 100% of the market, the ones who own the houses and the ones who are looking for houses, right? I mean, both ends.
Yeah.
I mean,
well, I mean, yeah, if you get people that, I mean, that are interested in doing a refinance, they call you, and you mean it's going to be really good if you know how to talk to them. You know, like this morning, you know, when I think somebody took the call as a $400,000 203K, he started choking on the phone, he passed it over to Fernando. You know, and you know, luckily the guy, I'm surprised he's still, I think you guys put him on hold for about 5 minutes.
Yeah.
So, I mean, to me.
Well, I mean, I was going to go forward, and then Mark was like, yo, it's in Maryland, you can't do it. And I was like, dang.
Well, no, but no, I mean, my point is that you can't, you know, most people aren't going to put up with that, first off. And so the guy doesn't know what he's saying on the phone, and then they put him on hold. You know, you can't.
Well, John gave it to Rustin, the Rustin gave it to me. It was like, pass off.
Well, I know, but the thing is that the point that I'm trying to get at is that you have to know, you need to be, you know, master of the domain, become an expert in it.
We did, Sean. And,
so
throw it over my way, bro.
That's a you know, you become a master of something. You can, I know a guy that is in California. All he does is mobile homes, so he makes about $1 million a year.
Mobile homes, eh?
That's big, man. In the rural areas.
Yeah.
Everywhere, even in the Bay Area, San Diego.
Yeah. All he does is mobile homes. Yeah. He won't even do a USDA or FHA purchase.
Wow.
But you know what? He gets all the big mobile home deals.
Yeah.
Quadruple wide.
No, I'm just saying, like, you know, you identify what it is and you go after it. So, I mean, that's what we've done with the USDA. And so, anyway, that's it for tonight, guys. Can you save that and send that to me or Josh? Josh, something to say.